Shalom, everybody. Peace and blessings. It's Tazara, here to share some interesting historical information with you. What I'm about to share ties directly in with what Dante has been recently sharing with us in his recent videos, especially the video he did about Israelites being on transatlantic slave ships. I want to point out that the following historical information was produced by scholars with a European background. I point this out so that the people who hate us and spend all of their time trying to discredit researchers from our community, like Dante, can't claim we're using biased information from Afrocentric sources as an excuse to slander and attack us. The European scholars who wrote this information had nothing to gain by recording the fact that black people in West Africa were Jews. They were simply writing down and recording everything as they saw it. So, we're going to be taking a look at a total of three different sources, all of them dealing with the same topic, black Jews in West Africa. The information from all of these sources combined together is going to show us that very large numbers of black Jews in West Africa were enslaved by Europeans and transported from West Africa by Europeans to North America on cargo slave ships to Louisiana specifically, and also the Caribbean. The first two sources we're going to look at are going to lay the foundation for the third and final source that we're going to be looking at. Before we get into the third source, it's important that this foundation be set up for historical context and also for the people who are unaware that these first two sources even exist. Now, the third and final source we're going to be looking at really hit close to home for me when I first saw it a while back because my father's side of the family is from a small town right outside of New Orleans, Louisiana, called Reserve. My great-grandfather on my father's side, which would be my father's grandfather, was the firstborn of many siblings in his family, and his parents were sharecroppers. While he was growing up, his family still lived on or near the plantation that their ancestors were slaves on. Although they themselves weren't slaves, the only work available to his parents was sharecropping on the plantation. Now, my great-grandfather's grandfather, which would be my great-great-great-grandfather, was named Moses. I believe he was born in the early 1800s, so it's safe to say he was a slave. I wish I had an interesting story about how or why he was given the name Moses, but I don't. I just thought it would be an interesting thing to mention. So anyways, I'm sure a lot of you have seen these first two sources before, and if you have, it's okay, because I personally noticed that sometimes when you go back and review information you've already read, you might notice key bits of information that might not have stuck out to you the first time. So with all that being said, let's get to it. The first source is entitled The Earth and Its Inhabitants, Africa, by L.S.A. Recluse, published in 1882. You can see right here, this is the title page if you want to look it up on your own. And this is a short biography on L.S.A. Recluse. Let's see what it says. Jacques L.S.A. Recluse was a renowned French geographer, writer, and anarchist. He produced his 19-volume masterwork, is the name of it, over a period of nearly 20 years. And here's more information on him if you want to look him up. But we're going to be on page 267. Now on this page in this book, we're going to be reading about a place called Dahomey. So for those of you who don't know what Dahomey is, we're going to take a quick look to see what Dahomey is or what it was. You can see it says Benin. Benin, officially Republic of Benin, French Republic du Benin, formerly until 1975, Dahomey, or People's Republic of Benin, country of Western Africa. So we can see Dahomey is present-day Benin. And if we go down, we can see right here there's a map. They show where Benin is, present-day Benin. Here's another photo of a map from the same website, Britannia Encyclopedia. And you can see right where Benin is on the other map, they have Dahomey right here on this map. So this is where Dahomey is. And we're going to be reading about a place called Judah, located in Dahomey. So now we're back on page 267 of The Earth and Its Inhabitants. Let's take a look at what it says about Dahomey. Dahomey. East of Great Popo begins the Dahomey territory, guarded by the important town of Glewe, known to Europeans by the various names of Fida, Hiseta, Wida, Wida. The old writers called it Judah, and its inhabitants were said to be Jews, while the neighboring river Alala, whose real name is Ephra, became the Euphrates. During the flourishing days of the slave trade, from 16 to 18,000 were annually transported from Ajuda, as the Portuguese called this place, which at that time had a population of 35,000. Now, an important thing to note about this book is the fact that it clarifies all of the different names right here for this location is talking about the same place, Judah. It says Fida, Hesedah, Wida, Wida. The old writers called it Judah. So these are all different names for the same place in West Africa, in Dahomey. And we just saw where Dahomey is on the map. These are all names for the same place, which is Judah. It also says that its inhabitants were believed to be Jews. If you've been watching his recent videos, then you know Dante has shown another source that says these people were indeed a remnant of the lost tribes. I'm paraphrasing when I say that, but the bottom line is that there's no reason for anybody to be saying that they don't know why this place was called Judah or that they need to look into it. Best believe that if this place would have been called something like Cush, our haters would have no problem letting these people be Cushites or Hamites, and they wouldn't be saying they need to look into it. And best believe that if there was a place called Judah somewhere in Europe instead of Africa, our haters and people on the other side would have no problem letting those people be Jews, and they definitely wouldn't be saying they need to look into it. The last thing I wanted to point out about this source is the number of slaves it says were transported from Judah annually. Annually means yearly, okay? Let's look at it one more time. It says, during the flourishing days of the slave trade, from 16 to 18,000 were annually transported from Judah. Let's do some math. I've got my calculator pulled up. So let's read this one more time. It says, during the flourishing days of the slave trade, from 16 to 18,000 were annually transported from Judah. So 16 to 18,000 yearly. Let's go with the smaller number. Let's say 16,000 over a period of 10 years. That's 160,000 people from this location being taken as slaves. Now, let's be even more generous. Let's divide this by two. Let's say only half of them were Jews. That's 80,000 over a period of 10 years. Now, personally, I believe most, if not all of them, were Jews. We're just playing with numbers and, you know, getting an idea of what percentage of these people might have been Jews. So if we go 80,000 over a period of 10 years, that's quite a lot of black Jews being taken from this location. And we know the slave trade lasted longer than 10 years. So that's something that we should all keep in mind as we move on to the next two sources. And something else I probably should have pointed out sooner is that this source says nothing about these Jews being the descendants of Caucasian men who had sex with black African women, nor does it say that these Jews are converts. Okay, so let's keep that in mind as we move on to the next source. So now let's take a quick look at this next book. A lot of you may know this source already as well. It's called A Mission to Galilee, King of Dahomey, Volume 1, by Richard Francis Burton, published in 1863. And we can see right here in the title, it says Dahomey. So we know this book is going to be talking about Dahomey. And we just saw previously that Dahomey was in West Africa. And inside of Dahomey, there was a location called Judah where Jews were known to inhabit. This was written by Richard Francis Burton. Let's take a quick look at him. Sir Richard Francis Burton was a British explorer, writer, scholar, and soldier. He was famed for his travels and explorations in Asia, Africa, and the Americas, as well as his extraordinary knowledge of languages and cultures. Some more information about him if you want to look him up. We're going to be on page 191. The information that we want is right here. You can see it kind of cuts off from the previous page, but you guys can look this up on your own and read it if you want. What we want is right here. Pretty much it's just talking about the physical and geographic characteristics of Dahomey, West Africa. Well, let's look and see what it says right here. The eye dwells with delight upon the numerous country villages like the 115 towns of the tribe of Judah, and upon the thin forest of palms rising from the tapestry of herbage, here waving, there cut short, which combine to make this spot the Firdaus, or paradise of Dahomey land. So we can see Richard Francis Burton is identifying the people who live here in Dahomey land as the tribe of Judah. And we just read in the previous source, it says they were believed to be Jews. So this is pretty much confirming it, because we know for a fact that this book is talking about the same exact location that the previous book was talking about, Dahomey. The book we just read before this one said that the people who lived there were believed to be Jews, and this right here identifies them as the tribe of Judah. Something else I also want to point out is that Benaiah Israel has shown sources saying that Spanish or Portuguese Jews were the tribe of Judah. All of this ties in together one way or another. Something else that's interesting to note is that after attacking Israelites for over a year, simply because we would share sources about the black Portuguese Jews being black, Faithful to God was finally forced to recently admit the black Portuguese Jews were literal black or dark-skinned people and not the quote-unquote dark complexion Caucasian people he was showing in his attack videos. If you haven't seen the last video about Faithful to God, he was basically forced to admit there were two different groups of Portuguese Jews being spoken of in these historical sources. One group being the Caucasian Jewish men, who had biracial or mulatto children with Native African women that he always references, and the other group being the dark-skinned black Portuguese Jews who were literally black. Dark-skinned black Portuguese Jews that Faithful has never talked about or mentioned before, by the way. Yet he confidently claims that he hasn't debunked himself by admitting this. But that just goes to show how insane and what a complete liar he is, because the whole reason he was attacking us in the first place was because we were saying the black Portuguese Jews were black people, and now he suddenly agrees with us after Abu admit they were black. But unsurprisingly, Faithful's now trying to come up with new excuses and arguments to explain away their blackness. I don't check Faithful's channel unless I'm looking for footage to catch him lying or contradicting himself, but the last I heard about him was that he was having a complete meltdown about all of this. We all know how badly Faithful wanted those black Portuguese Jews to be white people. Anyways, I'm not saying that all of the black Jews we're reading about in Judah, West Africa, came from Spain or Portugal, but it wouldn't be crazy to suggest that a decent amount of them, or at least some of them, had come from Spain or Portugal, because we do know that according to numerous historical sources, the black Portuguese Jews were banished to West Africa as slaves, and that they also claimed to be from the tribe of Judah, according to a source that Benaiah has shared in his Hidden Hebrew series. So either way, at the end of the day, the black Jews in Judah, West Africa, were the same people as the black Jews in Portugal, even if they were in different locations. But that's all I'm going to say about that, because more research would need to be done on my part to go further into it. And before we move on, I want to show some images of the people who inhabited Dahomey. You can see I've typed in people of Dahomey right here in the search bar. This is what they look like. Black people. And you can also see a lot of things talking about female warriors, the all-female warriors, or Dahomey Amazons. A lot of information about them is popping up. If you've seen Black Panther, you know that there were women warriors in that movie, and this is where they got that idea from. You can read up on the history about these warriors, the female warriors of the Amazon, of Dahomey. It's some interesting history, but it's not really relevant to what I'm going into here, so we're gonna move on. So we've just read two historical sources saying that black people in Judah, West Africa, were Jews, and the second source we just read even went as far as identifying them as the literal tribe of Judah. Not converts, and not the descendants of white Caucasian Jewish men who were running around Africa getting native black women pregnant. And as it's been mentioned, both of the two sources we've just finished reading were talking about the same exact location in West Africa, Judah, which was in Dahomey, or present-day Benin. Now this third and final book is going to tell us what happened to these black Jews who lived in Judah, West Africa. Like I said, when I first saw this source a while back, it really hit close to home, so I took a screenshot of it and added it to my collection. I had completely forgotten about it until someone posted it again recently and it showed up in one of my social media feeds. I felt that it would be a good addition to the sources Dante has been sharing with us about Israelites on slave ships. It's called Africans in Colonial Louisiana, The Development of Afro-Creole Culture in the 18th Century by Gwendolyn Midloe Hall, published in 1995. Louisiana State University Press, LSU. Now let's take a quick look at Gwendolyn Midloe Hall and see who she is. Gwendolyn Midloe Hall is an American historian who focuses on the history of slavery in the Caribbean, Latin America, Louisiana, Africa, and the African diaspora in the Americas. You can see her education, credentials. You can look her up if you want to. Let's keep going. The book is available on Google Books as well as Archive. We're going to be reading it on Archive. If you want to read it on Archive, you have to make a free account and they'll let you check it out for a certain amount of time. It's always free. You can always recheck it out once your time expires, but we're going to be looking at it on archive. You can see that it's the same book, Gwendolyn Midloe Hall, Africans in Colonial Louisiana. Here's the information if you want to look it up on your own. Let's get into it. We're going to be reading from a few pages out of this book, and we're going to see what it says about the slave trade from Judah, West Africa. Before we begin, something important to note is that the information in this book appears to be mainly dealing with the final years of the slave trade out of Judah. As we read in the very first source, 16,000 to 18,000 slaves were taken from Judah yearly, or annually, during the flourishing days of the slave trade. So we're starting out on page 34. Let's see what it says. The French presence was well established in Senegambia long before the African slave trade to Louisiana began. French traders had asserted their right to a monopoly of trade in Senegambia in 1664. French trading posts had long been established at Goree, at St. Louis, at the mouth of the Senegal River, and far up the Senegal River at Galam. Now let's go down a little bit to right here. Although the Company of the Indies had a trading post at Judah, Whidda, on the Gulf of Benin, it competed there with all the nations of Europe. The Portuguese were taking the upper hand at Judah. The kings of Ardres, Alada, or Porto Novo were hostile to the Europeans and interrupted the trade. The slave trade at Judah was becoming uncertain and unprofitable. So we can see right here, this book is talking about the same exact location that we were reading about in the previous two books. Benin or Dahomey, Judah. Between 1726 and 1731, almost all the slave trade voyages organized by the Company of the Indies went to Louisiana. So now that we've established that this book is talking about the same locations we just read about in the other two books, let's get further into it. We're now on page 62. It says the captains, talking about the captains of the slave ships, were ordered to make their first stop between Cap Diamante and Cap Mesurate, where they were to take on enough water and wood for the voyage to America. They were to try to obtain more water at Judah and corn to feed the slaves. Along their way to Judah, they would stop off at Cap Lahau, Jacques Lahau, and Jacques Jacquet at Cape St. Apolline to trade several blacks and some rice, but they were not to stay more than 2 or 3 days at each place. After leaving Cape St. Apolline, they were to avoid the coast until they arrived at Judah, where they could stay 10 or 12 days and trade as many blacks as possible. Upon their arrival at Judah, they were to give the normal presents to the king. L'Aurore, if you look up L'Aurore, this is the name of a slave ship. L'Aurore was estimated to be big enough and supplied with enough merchandise to trade 400 slaves. Le Duc Dumaine, another slave ship, 500 to 600. On arriving in Louisiana, they were to dock at Dolphin Island. Now, if you look up Dolphin Island, it's an island in the Gulf Coast. I believe in modern times it's considered a part of Alabama, but back then, all of that area was considered Louisiana. Now, before we continue, I want to stop for just a second and show a map of what America looked like during the time period that this book is talking about. This book is dealing specifically with the early 1720s. In a few years prior to that as well, you can see Louisiana was all of this right here. It was much larger than what it is today in modern times. If you know about history and the Louisiana Purchase, Louisiana was purchased from the French. And when it first existed, it encompassed all of this right here. Maybe even more than this. There are other maps as well that you can look at. But what I'm saying is, back in 1720, Louisiana was much larger than what it is today. It wasn't just that little boot-shaped state that it is now. It encompassed all of this area here. Mississippi, Alabama, all of that. All the states here that are what they are now today, back then, they were all Louisiana. Modern-day California would have been over here. You can see right here it says New Mexico, and this is Mexico. So now we're back on page 62 of the book. Let's continue where we left off. On arriving in Louisiana, they were to dock at Dolphin Island. The instructions pay a great deal of attention to minimizing mortality. The captains were to complete their trade as soon as possible, since the health of the blacks and the success of the voyage depended upon the time the slaves remained aboard the ship. To avoid prolonging their voyage and exposing the slaves and the crew to disease, the captains were ordered to make no stops in Africa or America after leaving Juda, except at the island of Grenada in the West Indies, where they could take on wood, water, and whatever refreshments they needed. They were to remain at Grenada for as short a time as possible. The captain, the officers, and the surgeon were instructed to take good care of the health of the blacks, to prevent the black women from being debauched by the black men in the crew, and to clean and scrape the slave quarters every day to avoid rot. They were to avoid purchasing slaves who were more than 30 years old or less than 8 years old. They were told to do their best to avoid pirates. When La Aurore, the slave ship, arrived at Juda on October 18, 1718, there were 3 English, 4 Portuguese, and 3 French ships in the harbor. There were 2 French, 1 English, and 1 Portuguese ship at nearby Jacquin. 3 more English ships belonging to the South Sea Company and a Dutch ship were expected. This large number of ships seeking slaves was causing a sharp rise in their price. Slaves were becoming so rare that the director of the French trading post feared that their ships would have to leave with only half their cargo. And as you can see, we're on page 63 now. The Portuguese, bloated with the gold of Brazil, offered the stiffest competition. They were trying to monopolize the trade from Juda by offering exorbitant prices in gold. In 1721, the Portuguese built the fortress of Whydah, which is Juda, consolidating their predominance at the Gulf of Benin. Before La Aurore, the slave ship, left Juda, the nearby trading post at Jacquin had become impractical for Europeans because of the hostility of the King of Ardres. Therefore, all the European ships stopped at Juda, aggravating the shortage of slave merchandise. La Aurore left Juda on November 30, 1718, with 201 slaves, half the number the company expected her to carry. Although the voyage from Juda to Louisiana took about 6 months, only one slave died, a very low loss in transit for such a long voyage. The cargo, you can see it puts the word cargo in quotes here because it's talking about the slaves. The cargo was rushed to Pensacola to work on fortifications during the siege by Spain. Many of these slaves were reportedly lost when the Spanish took Pensacola. After a voyage of 3 months from Africa to Louisiana, Le Duc d'Ulmain, another slave ship, estimated to be able to carry 500 to 600 slaves, landed 250 in Louisiana. The sale of these slaves posed a problem that was to become chronic in Louisiana. As much as the colonists clamored for slaves, they could not pay for them in hard currency. After 2.5 months, not one colonist had come forward to make an offer. To avoid letting the merchandise, the slaves, deteriorate on Dauphin Island, the company agreed to accept payment in paper money issued by the new company, the Company of the West, as well as by Crozat, provided that if this paper money was not honored, the purchasers would pay for the slaves in kind or return them to the company. Meanwhile, the colonists would assume all risks for them. During 1720 and 1721, 3 voyages organized by the new Company of the Indies picked up their cargo, slaves, for Louisiana, from Juda, despite the severe shortage of merchandise there. La Africaine, another slave ship, landed 182 slaves, and Le Duc d'Ulmain, another slave ship, on its second voyage to Louisiana, landed 349. We're on page 64 now. Both ships arrived in March 1721. Now let's scroll down just a little bit. The slaves from La Africaine and Le Duc d'Ulmain were distributed to the colonists and concessionaries in groups consisting of 2 men, 2 women, a boy, and a girl. There were not enough slaves to satisfy all those who had asked for them. However, with La Nereide, another slave ship, arrived the following month, the concessionaries took few slaves because they had nothing with which to feed them. Of the 825 slaves who arrived on La Africaine, Le Duc d'Ulmain, and La Nereide, 537 were sold to individuals and 35 died after landing, leaving 253 slaves. 40 of the remaining slaves were kept to work on boats going up the Mississippi River to the Illinois country. The Negrelons, boys, were sent to New Orleans to be sold to those who wanted them, and several Negres Pies d'Inde, adult males, were to be kept for public works and to provide for their subsistence. La Fortune, another slave ship, the final ship from Juda before the slave trade focused almost entirely on Senegal, arrived 2 months later. So I've jumped down to page 72. Let's see what it's saying on page 72. Let's start right here. Pauger chief engineer of the Louisiana Concession, wrote that while the arrival of the blacks from La Moutine and L'Aurore, these are slave ships, while the arrival of the blacks from La Moutine and L'Aurore pleased the colony infinitely, it is a small number compared to the pressing need one has of them to prevent the colonists, mainly the best of them, from returning to France, disgusted because they have had to wait so long for them, and because of the disgraceful rule of this colony. Some of these slaves were kept by the company to engage in public work projects, including the construction of a large permanent levee to protect New Orleans from flooding and cutting down trees in the city to let air to reach the windmill and to allow for tilling the soil. Many of you have ever been to New Orleans, you know that there are levees built alongside the Mississippi River. What this book is saying is that the black slaves from Judah were the ones who built the levees. Let's keep going. Now the last page we're going to read from is page 75, as you can see right here. You guys can look up this book on your own if you want to read everything that was in between. I'm just skipping through for time's sake, but let's see what page 75 says. Peace and stability arrived in Senegal just as Judah went up in flames. The daughter of Dahomey overthrew the kingdom of Judah. On March 3rd, 1727, Captain Rangard of Le Marie, which is another ship, wrote a detailed eyewitness account of the warfare, which totally disrupted commerce in the region. On February 12, 1729, the captain of the slave ship Le Méduse wrote from Judah, "There are no more inhabitants and the country is deserted. You can image how hard it is to find captains." And then it goes on into saying how they started targeting Senegal afterwards. So as you can see, it finishes talking about Judah by saying that they pretty much took everyone from there that they could, and that in the end, Judah ended up being destroyed, and there were no inhabitants left, and the country was deserted. So, we've just finished reading three different historical sources that all tie in together and paint a very clear picture showing that Judah, West Africa, was known to be inhabited by black Jews, the tribe of Judah specifically, and that these black Jews of Judah, West Africa, ultimately ended up being captured and sent on cargo slave ships to the Caribbean, but mainly America, Louisiana specifically. The third book we just read from identifies so-called Africans who came on slave ships to America as being the Jews spoken of in these older historical sources, even if it does so indirectly. And as I mentioned just a little while ago, the very first source says that 16,000 to 18,000 slaves were taken from Judah yearly during the flourishing days of the slave trade. Since this book mainly deals with the final years of the slave trade out of Judah, it doesn't really give an explanation as to each location where all the slaves went before that, but it makes it very clear that these black slaves from Judah were being taken by European slave ships and that large amounts of them were in fact being taken to Louisiana. The last thing I want to point out is how the first two books we read identify the black people being spoken of in Judah, West Africa, as Jews and the tribe of Judah. The first source we read from was published in 1882, and the second one we read from was published in 1863. Then when we get to the third source that we just finished reading from, which was published in 1995, the people who were taken from Judah are now being referred to as blacks, black slaves, and Africans. The words Jew or Jews cannot be found written in that book a single time, yet we know for a fact that the black people being spoken of in the book were the black Jews being spoken of in the two older historical sources that we read first. So over 100 years ago, we were known to be Jews, and we were recorded as being the tribe of Judah in European historical sources, but now we're Africans, or African Americans, or blacks. Evidence and proof of a conspiracy or cover-up is right in front of our eyes, and this is a perfect example of why it's important for Israelites to always use older historical books as primary sources and references. Otherwise, you'll have people telling you that black didn't actually mean black, or that they don't know why Judah was called Judah and that they need to look into it, or that you're just a black African who is having an identity crisis. Just think about all of the black descendants of slaves who have picked up the third book we just looked at, and how many of them read about how it talks about black African slaves being taken from Judah, West Africa. And imagine how many of them just read it and went on with their life without knowing that those people weren't actually black Africans, but Jews from the tribe of Judah. Hopefully anyone watching this can easily see what's going on here. At this point, we aren't doing this to convince our haters or people on the other side, because they know the truth. They just don't want us to know it. Information like this needs to be brought out for those of us who are on the fence, or for those of us who are still being fooled by the lies and deception. The lies need to continue to be exposed, and the people who tell these lies need to continue to be exposed. So with that being said, I want to give all praises to the Most High God through His Son, Jesus Christ, or whatever name you personally call Him, and Shalom.